Hi, I'm Sanjay Nagchowdhury, Development Lead for the IBM App Connect Enterprise product. In a previous video, I demonstrated a new capability in version 12 to create a JUnit test for a message flow node. In this video, I'll describe more details about how to use the classes that are required to create the test case. So let's recap what I showed in the previous video. I have a flow here which transforms a message from XML format to JSON format. If I put a message through using the flow exerciser, we can see that the XML message here has been transformed into a JSON message here. So I can create a test case for the compute node here, so that I can later add it to my pipeline to make sure that the capability in the flow doesn't regress. So I can select create test case, which launches a wizard here. I can select to choose an input XML file from my workspace, and I can select a JSON file to compare against, so I can compare the actual message against the expected message. And as I change the options on the left hand side of this wizard, it changes what test case is about to be generated by the wizard. Okay, so let's click finish, and then we can run the test and then look at the details of the test. So the test case has been created, it's been added to a test project, and I can run that test project, and the results are shown in the JUnit view here, and you can see that the test has passed. But what's actually been generated? So let's have a look at some more details. So let's start with a test project. So this is a first class artifact that has been added to IBM App Connect Enterprise version 12. If we look at the properties, we can see that in project references, it has a reference to the application that is under test. If we have a look at the build path and look at the libraries, we can see it's using JUnit 5, okay? And it's also using a library called Integration Test Library, and that has references to a collection of jar files that are required for testing a node or a subflow. The main jar file that's used is Integration Test.jar, okay, and other jars are also used, so that you can use hand pressed matches, and you can use comparisons. You can use comparison methods to compare XML and JSON. So the test project has a structure which allows it to be used with Gradle and Maven, and in a later video I'll show how to build a test project using Gradle. Okay, so now let's have a look at the test case itself that's been generated. So it's been created in a package called test. It has the necessary imports automatically added to it, and there are three classes of interest that we'll talk about. So we have here a spy object reference. So if I click here and enlarge this, you can see some of the new classes that are provided in the integration test.jar. So I'm going to talk about spy object reference and node spy and test message assembly. Okay, so we start off with creating a new spy object reference. So a spy object reference is an object that's used for creating mocks at test time. Okay, it references ACE artifacts, so application, message flow, and node. It uses chainable methods to reference the artifacts using a fluent API. And in this test code, a reference to the compute node is being built up by specifying the application, the message flow, and then the node itself. Okay, so next we are initializing a node spy. So A node spy allows you to observe the node behavior at test time. You can use it to send a message assembly to an input terminal using an evaluate method. You can also use it to write assertions about what the node does, for example, how many times the node is called. And you can also use it to assert which t node terminals are passed through. And we are also creating a test message object. And the test message assembly object is represents something called a message assembly. So a message assembly represents the instance of a message at a given point in time in the flow. Okay, it's comprised of four different trees. So they are the environment tree, the local environment tree, the exception list, and the message tree. And the message tree comprises of the message header and the message body. So the test message assembly class can be used to call the message flow node at test time, and it can be also used to assert the behavior of a node. I'm actually going to go into more details about message assemblies and how to edit them and use them in a separate video. So let's now look at this bit of code, which is constructing the input message assembly. So in order to drive a test case, an input message assembly needs to be sent to the input terminal of the compute node. Okay, so the input message assembly is built up from the XML file that I've selected in the wizard, and it uses a method called build XML message to so that method is called on the test message assembly object that I created for the input, and that will create the message assembly using that XML message. Now, after that input message assembly is formed, it is sent to the input terminal of the compute node using the evaluate method. So the evaluate method is a method that's available on the node spy object. Okay. And in this case, you can specify the message assembly. You can specify in the second parameter, you can specify whether it's a single node test or not, and then you can specify the name of the input terminal. So in this case, I'm testing a single node, so I'm setting the second parameter to true because it is a single node test, and for the last parameter, I'm setting it to in, which is the name of the input terminal. The next part of the test case has a couple of asserts. So these are using handcrest matches on the node spy object to assert the behavior of the compute node. The first matcher is called node call count is, and that is used to assert how many times the node is invoked. Okay, and in this next assert, I'm using a matcher called terminal propagate count is, and that is asserting how many times a message is being propagated to a particular output terminal of a node. So in this case, an assert is made that the message is propagated to the out terminal of a compute node, and it's propagated one time, once. In the final part of the test case, I am constructing the expected message, and I am comparing the actual message that's propagated against the expected message. So to do this, a second test message assembly object is called. So I'm calling it actual message assembly. Okay, and that is constructed by calling a method called propagate message assembly on the node spy object, and that's returning a test message assembly object. Okay, I can then call get message body as string on the actual message assembly. Okay, and that returns a string which is the message body as a string. So that's the actual message that's been propagated to the output terminal. I now need to compare it against something. So I've got a JSON file that I used, and from that JSON file, I can create a string which is the expected output data. And then I'm using a matcher called JSON equals, all right? And that's taken from one of the JSON jars that I used, and asserting that the actual message matches the expected message, okay? So that's the breakdown of this particular test. Now what I can do is add some debugging if I wanted to. So for example, I can use system.out.println if I wanted to print the expected data that is being used here. And what I can do is run this test. So run the test project, and we'll see that this output comes to standard out here. Now, if, for example, I had changed the expected data to be something else, so for example, if I did expected output data equals, and let's change this to say person, for example, and say that if I run it now, we can see that the test fails. So it was expecting person, demo was actually sent. So what I can do is put a breakpoint in the code. And what I can do is, so there's a breakpoint that's been set. And what I can do is run the test using the debugger. And when I run the test with the debugger, it will allow me to switch to the debug perspective, and I can see the actual output data, which has demo, and the expected output data, which has person. So I can debug the unit test if the unit test suddenly fails, so that I can understand why the values don't match. So in this video, I've explained the internal workings of the test case that's been generated. I've described three classes that I used, so spy object reference, node spy, and test message assembly. I've shown how handcrest matches can be used to assert the behavior of a node. I've shown how to build a message assembly and then compare the data, and finally I have shown how to debug a test case and examine why it has failed.